minutes each and 9 talks altogether. So it's going to be a pretty full day. And afterwards, we are going to have also the evening happening today in the pub Angleterre. And we made a decision that we are starting the panel discussion there round about 7, so everybody has time enough to move to the city center and also grab a little food. There is no food in the bar, so the pub is not that big, so if you want to drink before going there and have drinks, if you want to grab something to eat, please do it. There is plenty of rather nice and good restaurants around the pub and not far away at all. Okay, Karsten Gerloff is a little bit late, that's why we made a decision that Jarkko Moilanen is actually starting this best practices session. Oh, there is a Karsten. But Karsten, we made a decision that Jarkko is beginning, so you can grab your breath and you don't have to jump straight on desk there. All right. And the topics what we are handling today is that Jarkko is very well known community manager, especially from the Migo days, and he's talking about how not to do open source from the community manager's perspective, that what are those mistakes that companies are quite often do when interacting with the communities. Then later on, Karsten is going on and talking about how this app-centric world is trying to take the grab on your throat and put you on the mercy of the commercial companies and how we can avoid that. And then last but not least, Aki Lassila is showing us a very interesting demo about our Finnish National Library and what they have done there. It became to cost knowledge this spring actually that we start to work together with the National Library, and actually National Libraries has a very big, substantial, big open source project going on there. And of course, since they are a library, they were thinking that it's not going to be interesting for anybody else than the librarians. But on the contrary, as we are such a community, that all working methods and what the boys are doing there is interesting. And thank you, Aki, coming here and giving the short demo. I believe that you are having talks on tomorrow there is another talk, so if you are interested about National Library, feel free to ask Aki that where that's going to take place. Okay, but that's about it. Matti, do we have any other practicalities for today that what we should
tell? If you are coming to the Proactum Open Meetup in the evening, please pre-register, you get one more drink. That's the motivation for that.
Yeah, there is one additional drink coupon for all those who have done the pre-registration.
And there is a link in our program page. So.
Yeah. Also, the pub will be very crowded. Yesterday there were already over 80 people registered, so we are expecting to have there more than 100 people coming together. So, hello, Laura. Nice to see you. Laura Matus from Estonia. You made it. Great. So, do the registration if you can. If you can't, you won't be thrown away, and we're gonna squeeze you in. But anyhow, let's go forward, and I welcome Jarkko Moilanen on stage, and Jarkko, floor is yours.
Hi to all. As it was clear, my name is Jarkko Moilanen. I'm here to. I was given a task to tell you about how not to do open source, but I'm a positive person, and such a topic is a negative one. So I took the liberty to include both how not to do and how to do. And that should work as a comparison between alternatives for you. I like to say that I live the open source. I do research about open source communities for my PhD. I've been PhD candidate for 2 years now, and my first article was published last week, so one step closer to my PhD. But I also participate in open source. I've been in open source for years now, mostly in community managing or enabling communities, not as a coder or developer as such, but occasionally some development also. I was the MIGO Network Finland community manager. I established it and was the first manager. Then I also started a local hackerspace in Tampere. I'm involved in Devamo also, and also somewhat involved in Mayor project, which is basis for the forthcoming YOLA devices, whatever they might be. But I live in the open source, and that's why I'm here. I know how it works, and perhaps I know how it should be done based on my research and interviews with different kind of staff from different kind of open source projects. As I said, is there a right or wrong way? That's a question mark. It depends on your situation and the community and the product. If you choose to have a community and do open source, it can be cumbersome and complex mesh. It's not a simple organization as it might be in some companies. And it's not the least painful way in my experience. But there are some things that might make it easier for you or harder. Well, as I said, it's your choice. Do you believe in lively, enthusiastic and proactive communities and want to adapt to changes faster, get innovative solutions and options, or do you want to get quick profit and believe that your internal work and teams are more creative, efficient, and whatever compared to open source community? And if you believe that sharing skills and information should be avoided, well, then you can step outside because I have nothing for you. It might be clear that I believe in the first one. So no one leaving. So you decided to stay. Okay, good. A fair warning, if you're thinking about doing open source development with some communities and your staff is not familiar with open source values and practices and communities or has no history in the open source development, well, get some help. If you just jump in, you're gonna drown. It's not a YOLA or saving boat. It's just jumping in the ocean. Okay, there's a claim, we just use open source. I claim that that's quite common in companies. You just use it. You don't contribute back. You don't live with it. You don't do it with the community. You just take it. And that's quick profit. Go ahead. Normally, companies see communities a bit like that. They are not inside the community, and they are above the community. They are arrogant. The opposite is what I suggest that companies should do, is try to live inside the open source, be inside the community, be part of it, and see the benefits are great. I will tell you about those a bit later. But it does require that the company does some organizational changes. And at best it combines two or more networks, because open source communities are not inside a bubble, they are connected to each other. So you get more and more networks by participating in one community. And as I said, it can be cumbersome and it's a mesh, it's not clear-cut. But you should embrace the organizational overlapping from your internal teams to open source community. One other thing is that the overlapping developer roles. In companies, in some companies, developers are seen rigidly or just developers. People in human resources don't understand that developers come in different shapes and colors. I'm not talking about your skin color, I'm talking about their relation to the work and hobbies and everything. Some businesses think that they can turn their own developers to open source developers overnight by saying that now we are doing open source. But the people, the developers, if they are not accustomed to open source development, values, communities and practices, they can't participate in the community. Often they are given strict boundaries, no freedom at all. You're doing this, this, this and that, and that's final. And they normally have internal company tools which are supposed to be used in the development. You don't use any other tools. This is the given set and you use this. Instead, in open source world, if a company is involved in open source in a good way, they have hired some open source people from the communities. And they have educated their existing people, developers, to the values of the open source communities and practices. And they embrace the free time hacking. It's not seen as a negative thing if you're doing something not as a product, but something like a hack, like a test of concept that just does it really work. That is seen as a positive sign and positive activity. And that comes in different forms. For example, having a free hacking Friday every B-weekly or something like that. I think Google did that at least some time ago. And give credit for the open source activities and enable the developers choose the tools from if not completely freely, then give them some kind of options that you can use these three tools instead of giving them just one tool set. And if your developers are not open source prone, but your business is, then I suggest that you replace your human resources because they have failed big time. And then there comes these certificates. Businesses love certificates. And they just hire developers with certificates. And that's it. That's final. I've seen that a lot. They normally want 9-to-5 developers. These names for the developers are on top of my head, and they are not formal or anything. I just named those in some blog that I wrote. 9-to-5 developers, they are the typical, they come to office, they work on their desk, and when clock is 5, they leave, and that's it. And they normally do some internal app development. But then you should have also these focused 24/7 developers. They are not doing it just for the money, but they do it, do the app development, and they contribute to the community. It might be code, it might be their free time or something, but they contribute to the community. They keep the community alive. And then there are these enthusiastic people spread 24/7 developers. They live the community. They live inside the community. They are the community. It's a lifestyle. This is hard to get, you know, for the people in companies, that it's a lifestyle. It's not your hobby, it's your lifestyle. And they do development in multiple areas. They work in some kind of core components. They do apps. They do tools. They organize events. They do a lot of things. They are not just doing 9-to-5 development and that's it. They are contributing to the community all the time. And of course, if you want to be a good company, you create a good community by having all these three types. You need all of those. Those are not exclusive. And then you need active users or happy hobby developers as your user base, which will eventually test your cases. Don't hire just these certificated 9-to-5 developers. Get some diversity in the development. And then your attitude, company attitude towards what you're doing in your or office hours or when you're working. Hackers and open source developers love freedom. And they want to do what really drives them. They are not at their best when you give them a specific task. That's what the 9-to-5 developers are for. You can outsource that to India or something. But for the creative stuff or new stuff or new concepts, use the open source people because they are driven by, their motivation is different. It's not money, it's the attitude and the yearning to learn something new and new tools and methods. And that's another thing that the human resources should be adjusted towards open source. And company values, well, we follow profit only. If it doesn't make us any profit in this quarter, we're not going to do it. That's common attitude in some companies, at least. Try to look beyond the next quarter, possibly even next year. And the wrong attitude is to turn community efforts, code, applications, tools into quick cash, quick profits. And normally, developers are not allowed to seek outside the box for new approaches or tools. They have fixed plans and teams and rely on internal skills and a fear of losing the control. That's quite common. That if you open source something or do cooperation with open source communities, you're going to lose the control. Well, you don't have to. But if you don't know what you're doing, you will. And companies prefer to think that they are bigger than the communities. I know I'm not anti-company person. I run two companies myself, but the given topic was what was given. So don't get me wrong, but companies should learn a lot from open source culture. And as I said, more give them freedom, make them like their job, give them fun and new tasks. And as I said, they love alternatives and they are make-oriented. They don't want to talk. You don't get credit for talking. You get credit for doing. If you code, if you're a coder, you code and you put your code outside for others to see, and they value you by the code. And sharing is a built-in value. You don't expect a quick buck, quick profit, or something in return. But you just give, and you know that at some point it will come back to me. Then about cracks in the shell, as I said, companies normally fear losing of control if they open their development in some parts for the community and open source. Well, you don't have to. The wrong way doing it with the communities is that you make all your decisions about your development in the background, and all your decision makers are from your own company. You use only internal information flow, and you have your own bug trackers, other resources, and you keep your code hidden and stall the release until the product is finalized. And you dictate the changes that's going to happen with the device, with the product, whatever it is. The opposite is that you involve the community inside the development. Make the decisions in public whenever possible. I'm not saying that every decision should be public, but whenever it's possible. Involve all, well, again, relatively. I encourage to bring up some people from the community who are key players there, and involve them, engage them more strictly. more and more. Use public methods in your communication. Don't hide information behind some kind of firewalls or something. And whenever possible, share your resources, for example, bug tracking or code base, repositories, wiki pages, whatever you have. And don't dictate changes, but rely on discussion. And a fair warning is that if you rely on discussion and you work with the communities, it's going to take longer. It's going to take time. But the payback is that you will get the community. They will work for you. But if you dictate changes, they will look for your actions for about 6 months and then they leave. Because they want to be involved. They want to be heard. They don't want to be the decision makers, but they want to be heard. So open up your communication and plans to build trust with the community. And I think this is the last one before discussion and questions. What to do? Well, don't open source all. When entering open source, you don't have to open source everything. You choose your parts, what you want to be open source. And it will mix you or put you in middle of licenses and everything. You have to be careful what you can share and what you can't hold back. Educate your staff about open source culture, not about coding, but about the culture and how they work, what are the values. Because if you don't know the values, you don't know how it's going to work. And hire some open source developers, of course, because they know how to operate in these communities. It's much faster way to get open source knowledge, culture knowledge to your company than educating your existing 9-to-5 Windows tools developers. And choose your community wisely, so you should constantly evaluate the communities that you are involved or planning to be involved or want to ditch. Evaluate all the time. What's going on? What's the direction? What's the mentality? Is it producing anything? And instead of doing what Intel and others are doing, don't get your community manager from inside. It has a built-in resistance because he or she is representing the company, period. And there's a boundary, built-in boundary. So get a community manager from outside if possible. He or she might then act as a third party, which is a bit neutral. Engage your own staff to the community whenever it's fit. You don't have to engage everyone, but those who are working with open source, engage them and make them go with the community. Don't hold them back. And the last one is about the communication, which is all about building the trust with the community. They don't trust you if they don't know what you're going to do and what's your basis for your decisions and so on. I think that's about it. Questions?
Yeah, let me, before we go further on questions, actually there is two people in the audience that I would like to tease a little bit and stress the opinions. Excellent points, I think, and valuable for everybody. But first of all, Petri from Proactum, you are working on the company side and you are heavily leading your production environment on the open source and working with communities. I'd like to hear your opinion about these Jarkko's topics. That do you agree as a managing director of such a developing company? That's interesting. And actually behind you is Claudia Rau from the KDE. Claudia is a very well-known European community manager, and she overlooks tens or hundreds of different kind of projects there on the KDE office. Do you agree from the community perspective what Jarkko just brought up? That. So, Petri, what's your take on this?
Well, I do agree, although it's a very black and white picture that you painted in the board. So often the, let's say, communities are large in those technologies that companies use, and in a way the players or the companies that are involved in the community are let's say, one out of thousand, so of course your role in the community is rather small as a smaller player using the technology. But I do agree with let's say the ideology that share back and live with the community and not just take and use. And on the other hand, building on top of what the community has created can kind of create new projects or related projects, which you can again open source back to the community or create sort of related tracks with the original project.
Have you been doing any actions in your everyday life to encourage the people to turn from, as Jarkko was putting, 9-to-5 coders to us as a passionate 24/7 developers, or are you selecting only those 24/7 guys who are doing the work, or how it is? Do you encourage us as a company such a?
I suppose it comes rather naturally that when you position yourself as an open source company, you tend to get the people that are prone to open source already, so you don't need to kind of turn them from black to white, but people that join us have a tendency to be pro open source and embrace the community already.
All right. So in short, you would say that this topic were mainly okay, but
yeah, like I said, it's very very black and white in this.
Of course, of course. Okay, how about Claudia? What do you think about those topics?
I thought that was quite a good presentation and valid points from the community side. I can speak for KDE, which is quite a mature community, and we actually work quite a lot with companies. Also, we have quite a few companies that started from within the community. So it's quite a, as you said, it's quite a complex relationship between companies on the other side and community on the other side of the fence. Although many of our community members are actually, you know, on both sides, because they are hired by these companies that we work with or they founded the companies. So, of course, we see that there's a friction sometimes between, you know, company interests and valid company interests, obviously, and the community interests. But I have to say, so far we have quite a good relationship with our company partners, and for them, the community is a fantastic resource in terms of recruitment, obviously, because they can see what our contributors do. They can evaluate the code, and they can see, and our contributors that often start when they are students learn, you know, how to work with companies and how to work in this complex system of an open source project. So yeah, I agree with many of the points you made, actually.
Yeah. And then again, during this, I was kind of thinking as at the moment there is a huge phenomenon, at least here in the Finland, that the public sector organizations they are kind of thinking that how they could be more using open source, how they could be involved. Then again, everything what you brought up is kind of against old fashionable business rules, right? So this is really, really hard that how we are going to succeed here, that this 24/7 attitude, that how that can live there in the public sector organizations. That is maybe something that later on, Aki, you can enlighten a little bit, that how you have been successful there in the National Library and do these rules and kind of observations, do they apply there in your personal, how that is?
A little clarification about this developer roles before you go any further. One person can be 9-to-5 developer in a company, then leaves the office, puts another hat on, turns to focus developer or spread developer. But the understanding of this, that people have different hats, they might be working in some same project with different hat in different hours, and that's another thing.
Yep. And there is also some risk related to that. If you are thinking from the perspective of the individual developer, that at least in some countries the law defines that anything you do related in your work area, if you are a coder at work, your code coded at free time belongs to your company, or the IPR at least, or something. So this kind of challenge is also there. And sometimes I must say that if you work in a big company, and which traditionally is not an open source company, and then either you or someone gets an idea that, okay, let's go to open source, those guys who are put in there first might have really tough time, because the company processes don't really like support this model. And on the other hand, neither does the community model, because let's say that if you are in a typical sprint development in a company, you do something for a month, you do something else for the next month. This doesn't belong into community. If you take part in the project, you send your patches, the reviews, and whatever to get your thing through might take ages, and there is no timelines or schedules in the community typically. And in the next month you are already assigned to something else, and you cannot really spend your work time for that. And this creates a glitch between the company and the community. That's what I've seen also.
Okay. Jutta. Yeah.
In general, I agree from the perspective of the project in Munich, so developing the client for the city. Yes, it's black and white, but I'm missing a dimension in thinking, how can I implement that one? So I'm coming from there, from 9-to-5. I like to join with my developers, the community. I like to get that benefit. But what's missing there is the software engineering model I'm going to choose, which is below. Do I choose to do to develop in general waterfall model, or do I develop in an agile mode? So these are two extreme things, and if I start with that one, probably I'm really on the left-hand side somewhere, and then I have to think how I can send any patches to the community. So, and this is really from all the organization and management, the team, that's really a very tough challenge, and because you have nevertheless to integrate into your organization, you have to deliver at some schedule, so what the community in general does not. So this is belonging on the software engineering model you choose. So that's another important dimension which I would like to add over there.
That is an excellent point, and actually it's the topic what we talked with Jarkko when we were talking about the topic, but since we had only 30 minutes, we have to squeeze something, that otherwise it would be a kind of a full day. Elias, you had something?
Yes. To begin with, now I will switch the provocative mode on. As you were talking about the migration of IPA rights to the employer, were you talking about Finland or Scandinavia or Europe, or were you at all talking about civilized countries? I know that the migration is quite common in North America, but that's something quite different. And now I will switch off the provocative mode, and I will stress one lack which is quite common in the open source communities, and that is the lack of knowledge of the local legislation. And in spite of the fine terms and the how we want to do things and how we interact with people globally, we should always think about the local conditions, and that's something that is not in order inside the open source communities. In larger communities such as KDE, it's okay, but in smaller communities, the lack of knowledge is astounding. And in some cases it undermines the whole work, because it's not usable. For example, when it comes to copyright terms, and I think it's sad because the quality of code is good and the, you know, the goal is good, but due to these shortcomings, the situation is bad. And another issue that I had in mind that I would like to ask Jarkko is that, as far as I can see, in my personal opinion, the open source developers that I know are really the among the elites. They really are good. And the problem is that they from practical reasons, they have this attitude, which is quite common to the old-fashioned workers, that bosses, generally speaking, are stupid. Yeah, and those who have most of the power are even more stupid. And the problem, of course, is that as these developers are valuable assets and they can move around, how to lead them, how to govern them in an organization that really doesn't know how to play this game. And when it comes to, well, this is sort of a bit of rant also, when it comes to the situation in Finland, we have our companies that are quite good in open source and quite successful. But the problem is that the big players are not among these who can manage these kind of people. And my question is that, how do we overcome this problem? Because otherwise we are going to lose the game. And all of the Europe is going to lose the game, because they already know how to govern these people in some other parts of the globe.
Yeah, that's very, very good. I was kind of thinking that it would be similar as being a movie director and trying to get the Michael Jackson, Pink and Madonna and all these big stars into the same movie.
Exactly.
That's a challenge, yeah.
Which one of those is a stupid one, if you can
get back to the picture or the director?
I don't have a patent for that. It's more business-oriented question than community directly. But the basic is that, in my opinion, companies rely on bonuses and rely that will motivate people to stay, but that's wrong. It's about giving opportunities in your work time to do something else. I'm not telling you that every week I'm giving free hands to do whatever, but okay. One day in a week or one bi-weekly, I am allowed to use the company resources and do some stuff. You can require that the results will be presented to all in 15 minutes or something, but I have given freedom to do something, get my brain out of it or something. Instead of doing the same 9-to-5 job with some project which might be most interesting, but I need to get out sometimes to do my stuff.
Then and Jutta, and then we go forward. Yeah. Otherwise, we are destroying the schedule.
I could give a whole presentation on that one, because that's my daily life to manage between the open source and the management. But to make a long story short, really you have to establish a layer in between which is capable, the person who are capable to communicate between these management on the your CAO and all the rest of and on your open source developer, that you get a culture of acceptance. So independent what they do, but that first of all that they accept each other. That's really tough, but somehow it can work with the communication plan and whatsoever and traveling and benefits and a little bit of bonuses and freedom, but the layer is acceptance, to create acceptance between these groups.
Do you just out of interest, do you see that as anything, as a problem that's particular to free software and free software developers, or do you see that as a problem that's just a, let's say, a human resources issue? Some management issue that needs to be solved.
It's extreme with open source software developer.
Then you had a last question.
Yeah, maybe it's just for putting a problem out there, and it might be more appropriate in a different part of this sessions. But what I find, the first open source project I did was in a different time, and I'm now trying to redo and project, bring it out to the open. And what I'm missing a little bit here, but maybe this was not the focus of the talk, is how you how you do the first bump? How do you sort of get out? Because you need to do different things like check your code, make sure there's no stupid comments in your work tracker that can't go out and do the rules. So you have this sort of begin period. And I noticed that in, when you did in 2000, you sort of put up your finger and people were sort of willing to help you out with a starting foundation and sort of, it was easier, it seems. It seems if I'm now asking around, there's it's more difficult, or at least difficult, to find for a small company, how do you open up again? How do you get to the position where you are up and running in a way, and you can do it like this, you can select it like this, but how do you get to the first release in a way? Just notice that there is a difference now than I'm trying to do it than it was like 10 years ago. If that makes any sense, right?
Well, I agree that the communities nowadays have a lot more self-esteem. they respect their self, or the they're not exactly communities, but the developers, they know their value more now, and they expect more from the companies to get return. They are actually working opposite of their own values in some cases. They are expecting something from the company. For example, developer devices. That's we want those. We need those, and it's your task to give us those. And they are giving you ultimatums, and that's I'm not sure is it good or not. But I don't know. Is there an easy solution for a small company to get a lively community up and running?
Well, this is a practical problem. When I did this big project, you would sort of put up your hand and Sun and IBM and others would sort of give you quite easily money. And these days it's more difficult to set it up in the beginning to get to the point that we are talking about. So if you're a small company, your impulse is want to make it open source and want to share it. There's sort of a counter danger there, because the moment that you start doing it, developers will get questions, you have to answer them. And there's some, it seems to me that it's at least different for me when I'm talking in 2000 than the question if I'm asking it now. So maybe it's just because I don't know the rules of the game in this time period compared to 10 years ago, and I need somebody to help me out a little bit more how to do that. But I do notice that it's sort of missing in this story. How do you get in this over this first bump, which is clearly in development different than once you are here, once it is up and running and you have this community and you have this foundation or whatever construct you come up with. And at least it's giving me troubles, and I'm not sure if other people who are willing to bring stuff out to the open are somewhat confused or held back by how to do these first steps compared to before. Because it seems to me before it was easier, because it was even more popular and you didn't have to somehow, at least for me it was easier to just go like, please help me and bring something to the picnic, right? Bring something to the picnic, it was sort of expected, and these days it might not be the natural sort of impulse of other companies to start helping out.
Well, one reason for communities or developers in open source, which is lacking or not lacking, but stopping people to participate in new projects or projects driven by companies, different companies, is that some big players have been pissing on developers' knees. On their heads, they have bad experiences, and they are getting cautious. They don't go to any project. They want to see what it is, and they want to hear stuff, and then they make a decision to try it. And it doesn't guarantee that they're gonna stay. Yeah. If they are not happy with your practices, such as communication, openness, transparency, they will leave. But they are getting
guys. I really hate to disrupt, but we have a schedule to follow, and otherwise, because I know that Karsten is going to do the overtime again.
We knew that already.
So thank you. Let's give a big hand for Jarkko. Excellent, excellent opening. Thank you for that. And let's go forward. As I promised, Karsten is giving a little oversight of that, what's going on in the app-centric world at the moment, how companies are trying to get the squeezing hold on your throat through application and new gadgets and about freedom.
Just a second, I made a couple of last minute updates.
Just a second.
Here we go. Good morning, everyone. Now, we've just spent 45 minutes up to our necks in the details of how to work with the free software community, how companies can work with them. I think that was a very interesting discussion. Thank you. Now, before we head on into the rest of the day of discussing more details about how to get the best out of free software, I would like us all to take a step backwards and ask, why do free software in the first place? Why does it matter? Why is it important? Who here owns a mobile phone with an internet connection? Yep, that's most of you. Do you really own this device? Elias, okay, can you change the software on the device?
Yep.
Okay, do you know where the data goes that is on your device?
Yep.
What device do you have?
N9.
Okay.
Bad example, sorry.
Are you really sure about all the details of the operating system? Can you put another operating system on it?
Not 100 proof, but quite sure, yes.
Okay, then you're in a good position. Let's hope that the rest of us get there soon as well. Because, of course, our phones aren't really phones. Our phones are computers like this one, the ENIAC, one of the first computers in the 1950s. They're just computers that make phone calls, just like this laptop is in principle a computer that can make phone calls if I give it the right software. And there are phones are computers just like laptops are, just like routers are, just like TVs are, just like trains and planes are, just like some of Helsinki's trams are, but not all. And they're everywhere in our life. I tried to count the computers that I own in my house, and I came up to 18 before giving up, and that included a bunch of laptops, mobile phones in various states of decay, a stereo, an alarm clock, and a car, again, and many other things like that that we don't normally think of as computers, but they run software, and they are, in principle, and that is the point I want to talk about today, they are general-purpose machines. They are, they can do almost any task that is available to computers if you give them the right software. And a program just takes a computer and turns it into a specific machine for a time, right? If I fire up LibreOffice on this computer, then it turns into a typewriter for a while. And if I fire up, God forbid, Skype or something like that, then it turns into a phone. So, and some of these machines are packed in specific, in cases that make them look specific, but there's no reason why, for example, your router shouldn't also be a server. And general purpose computing is what has driven the IT revolution. General purpose computing has allowed computers to go to all these different places in our lives and be useful there. And they became especially useful when they were hooked up to general purpose networks like the internet, where they could exchange any sort of data as long as they could figure out how to talk to each other. And we all know how tremendously useful general-purpose computers and the internet are, but it's important to realize that we only get these benefits because these machines and these networks can do things that their creators never imagined when they built them. For example, sending cat pictures around the internet. Or perhaps less interestingly but more educationally, building a supercomputer out of Raspberry Pis. So this thing was built last week at the University of Southampton at the cost of $2,500, involving 64 Raspberry Pis plus a bunch of Lego bricks and the six-year-old son of one of the team as a design consultant. And it's a lovely example of what you can do when you take a general-purpose machine, and all of a sudden universities used to have to spend tens or hundreds of thousands of euros on buying supercomputers if they wanted to teach their computer science students on how to operate these things and program these things. And all of a sudden they can do it for a small four-figure number. Or for example, this young gentleman, he's 14 on the picture, and he's from Chile, and he has built an earthquake detection system using a household earthquake detector, which I gather are available in Chile, using an Arduino board and hooking that up to Twitter. You'll notice he's wearing a Debian shirt. So that now when the detector detects an earthquake, it sends out a message on Twitter, and that gives people about a minute's warning time to get out of buildings, which in the case of an earthquake isn't great, but given how bad we are at predicting them, it's a lot better than nothing. Now, these great things and many, many others are possible only because the computers that we have here allow don't impose any limits on our creativity. They let us do whatever we can dream up and whatever we can code. And the same goes for our networks. But at the moment, I'm afraid we're heading largely in the opposite direction. We're heading towards lockdown systems, and we're heading towards walled gardens on the network. And interestingly enough, this is not a question of technology at all. It doesn't matter which protocols you use. It doesn't matter what chip exactly is in your computer. What matters is who holds the power. It's a question of power, and it's a question of control. And that's what we need to think about. Who decides what's allowed on your computer? Who decides what you can do with it? And there are, so I'd like to take you through four problem areas where we have to decide and can take specific steps in order to take back the control of our computers. The first one, unsurprisingly enough, given who I am, is free software. Or rather, that's the solution area. The problem area that goes with it is non-free software. In the beginning, all software was free. In the US, software couldn't even be copyrighted until 1974. It simply came with computers as some, just like the manual, as something that you needed as a basic thing to operate the computer, and nobody questioned that. And only when software became copyrightable, then people started putting out proprietary software, and in due course, after a few years, the free software movement started in the early 80s. Now, I'm not going to recount that particular story here, because if you're here, you've probably already heard it many times, but today, free software is simply everywhere. It's on about two-thirds of web servers. The free software Android mobile operating system is leading the smartphone market by market share by a strong margin. And it's in all sorts of embedded devices. You can't spend a day, even if you're not on the internet, without running into free software somewhere. So this software that lets us use, study, share, and improve the programs, it's everywhere, but still many people think it's okay for software manufacturers to take these freedoms away from us and to give us software that we cannot use, study, share, and improve. To give us software that puts limits on our creativity and that does not let us do with it what we think is right, but only lets us do what the software maker thinks is right. Now, fortunately, there's an easy solution to that problem. We can use free software, and today that's really not very hard anymore. We can install this software on our computers, on any device we can get hold of, and we can take charge of our computing. We can be in power over what our machines do. So let's count that problem as more or less solved. We just need to tell more people about the solution. Then there's in a second problem area, which is grannies with guns, otherwise known as digital restrictions management. Digital restrictions management started out as a way for the music industry to preserve a business model that collapsed when suddenly everybody had on their desk a machine that could copy their products in a perfect state in unlimited numbers. So they started putting digital restrictions management on CDs, which all of a sudden meant that the CDs stopped working in most CD players. So that wasn't enjoyable to many consumers, but it was only the first of in the long row of disasters related to DRM. DRM at heart is an attempt to take something that's digital, that's replicable, modifiable infinitely, and turn it into something that's analog, that's hard to replicate and modify. In fact, DRM often makes the things it's applied to worse than the comparable analog products. For example, ebooks. If I buy a paperback book, I can lend it to anyone, and you may or may not give it back to me. But the solution to that problem is a phone call away. If I buy an ebook, I can't lend it to you. Now, I could lend you my whole ebook reader, but if you do that and you give it to your aunt, you really want her to know what page of 50 Shades of Grey you're on at the moment. And there the problem is that DRM is inherently customer unfriendly, and that it needs to be that way, because the whole purpose of DRM is to treat the customer as the enemy, as someone who needs to be locked out, and as someone whom the product needs to be protected from at all cost. So there's a solution to that, and it's well underway. Simply don't buy the crap. There are enough alternatives. People have stopped buying CDs with DRM on them. They partly stopped buying CDs altogether because the things wouldn't work properly. Some of the large sellers have started offering DRM-free ebooks, DRM-free music. So that's laudable. That solves part of a problem. There are still some companies that insist on DRM on a large scale. Apple's one of them. But if we don't give them our money, then this will not be very rewarding to them. So that's our choice. And I encourage you to make a smart choice there. The next point is, what software are you allowed to run on your device? If you own a general purpose computer, you can install, in principle, any operating system on it, provided you can get it to run on the platform. With things like Debian that work for more platforms than I've ever held in my hand, then that's not really a problem anymore. So, for example, if you're frustrated with DRM products, you can install an operating system that doesn't implement DRM. And that gives you full control over your computer. But for how much longer will that be the case? How much longer will such hardware be available to us? That's the problem we're facing at the moment. At the moment, something called secure boot is being introduced. We can also refer to it as restricted boot. And that basically means or what used to be called the BIOS, these days it'll be called UEFI, the bit of software that boots up, that starts up when you push the power button on your computer and then goes and fires up the bootloader in order to boot your operating system. That particular bit of software is going to check a signature on the operating system and whether that signature or the operating system image has been signed with an authorized key. Now, that is in principle a fine method of preventing malware and viruses from running on the computer, because if the software on the computer gets modified and it's no longer signed, it's different from the signed image, then you're not booting into an operating system that's essentially broken and harmful to you. The question is, who controls these keys? And at the moment, the answer is there's a certification chain, and you can buy a certificate for your keys for, I think, $99 at the moment. But the company that controls the certification process is Microsoft. And any hardware that wants to have the Windows 8 ready or whatever it is logo on it, which is basically anything that is being shipped at the moment, needs to implement this sort of restriction, this so-called secure boot system. Actually, my laptop has it already. Fortunately, some laptop makers let you turn it off in the BIOS. However, the option to turn it off is not available, according to the specification, on the ARM platform, which powers most mobile devices, which is where all the growth is in the coming years. So there we need to push back. There we need to find ways of being allowed to install any operating system we like on the hardware that we own. At this moment, it's not important whether we have operating systems that actually work. We do, but it's important that we have this option of installing something other than what's approved by a centralized authority. This sort of thing has been tried before with trusted computing, and the iPhone and the Xbox implement something similar, but secure boot is much more thorough. It goes to a much deeper level, and it's being applied much more widely than trusted computing ever was. So this, in consequence, means it's getting harder for you to control your own computer. So the first solution is buy devices that afford you control, that let you be in control of what's running on them, that let you decide what operating system you want to install, and help us work with people who can push, or with organizations who can push for change here. For example, antitrust organization or antitrust authorities and consumer groups. But this is going to be a tough one. And the fourth item that I'd like to talk about is where we move from the local computer to the network. Centralized systems. A lot of our computing doesn't happen anymore on the computer that's in front of us. A lot of our computing happens on the network somewhere, right? You log into your Gmail, for example, and then you have access to your mail, and it's not on your computer, it's on Google servers. In a way, that's the mainframe era all over again, where you have one big computing system a long distance away, and you log into that over the network. And because we give them so much data, these centralized systems have a lot of power over us. To put it provocatively, Facebook defines who we are, because it has all our social connections. Amazon defines what we want, right? They have a really cool suggestion system. Google defines what we think, because it shows us certain things and not others. And that's a problem not only in that it limits my horizon, it's also a problem in that if I want to talk to you, we're on the same centralized system, and I'm here and you're there, then I need to go through the centralized node, through the central node. And whoever controls that central node controls who I can talk to, whether the two of us can speak at all, what I can say to you, when I can say it, how I can say it. For example, we have a small baby at home, so if my wife were to send me a picture of her and our baby, then she'd have to take care that at the time the picture is taken, she's not breastfeeding the baby, because Facebook doesn't like babies being breastfed, at least not on Facebook. So they'd be liable to delete the picture at some point. And that's just a minor annoyance, but it's symptomatic for the problem of these centralized systems. If your other computer is a data center, then I hope it's your data center. The solution to this is already in front of us and has been there for at least 20 years. Build decentralized systems like these, where you still have a client-server architecture, but you have lots of servers that can all talk to each other. Email is an example where that works. And you can also increase the number of servers and try to have a server in as many places as possible. The Freedom Box project is on the way there, and there are many other attempts to create decentralized or even distributed peer-to-peer systems where there are no servers at all, where people on computers talk to each other directly. BitTorrent is an example of that that's very successful, if not to everyone's great joy. Something like building, we have many attempts of building, for example, social networks that are decentralized or peer-to-peer. And we're getting there, they're working. On the other hand, you'll say, yes, you'll never beat Facebook's, I don't know how many hundred million users they have today, because of the network effects. Facebook is so attractive because everybody else is there. Well, network effects are funny in a way, because they work for you before they work against you. When people, it's basically like a bank run. When people start distrusting that particular organization, then they tend to leave. And when they leave, they tend to leave in droves, and then the whole thing can collapse very quickly. See AOL, see MySpace, see all the other social networks that we don't even remember anymore.
So those are the four fields, the four problem areas that I wanted to take you through. Free software, or rather non-free software, digital restrictions management, the question of who decides what software you can run on your computer, and the question of who decides to whom you can talk on the network. The point I'm making is that computers are only cool and only great and only useful because they're general purpose machines. And the same goes for networks like the internet. And if it's not you that's in control of the machine, then to you that's not a general purpose system, whatever it may look like to someone else. Then it's not a system that you can innovate on. Then it's not a system that you can build a new company on unless you're willing to bet the farm and everything else on the fact that the underlying provider stays friendly towards you. And this gentleman here, he has nothing to do with computers at all. I think that's a very old fax machine on his desk there. His name is Gene Sharp. He runs a little place called the Albert Einstein Institute. And he's in his 90s, and there are a whole bunch of dictators around the world who are mortally afraid of him. He doesn't look very dangerous. But in the 70s, he wrote a three-volume book and then many others. The three-volume series was called From Dictatorship to Democracy. And in there, he listed hundreds of methods, hundreds of things that people can do when they're living in a dictatorship and when they want to bring that dictatorship down and assume power in a democracy, take the power into their own hands. Now, whenever people from places like Iran travel to his institute and take courses there, they tend to be arrested on re-entry because they've become too dangerous to their country and to the stability of the dictatorships there. So he seems to be rather effective. His book was the manual for the color revolutions in Eastern Europe, for the revolution in Serbia that brought down Slobodan Milosevic and many others. And his central thought is that power resides in the consent that we in society give to those who have power over us. And if we decide to withhold that consent, then the power comes back to us. So I've told you about a few practical ways of doing just that, of making sure you're in charge, of making sure you can use your creativity to build great things for tomorrow. And please, I invite you to join me in doing just that, in pushing for a world where we can be creative and free. Thank you.
Any questions or thoughts? Actually, there was one scary thing that popped into my mind since I participated in a little project in Africa where we were kind of making a chain that we are recirculating the computers from developed countries and taking them to the schools and different kind of businesses in Africa zone and actually wasn't thinking that much, but actually this food system that is that possible anymore that we are taking old machines from companies and kind of reinstalling Linux on them and give them to the African kids? That might be impossible, which is pretty scary.
With secure boot, yes, that might very well become impossible. Yeah. And that, I mean, you can go figure for yourself the implications for the environment.
Right.
Yesterday we talked about how many resources it takes to manufacture a simple CRT screen.
Yeah. Someone, if you are not familiar with that kind of I think that Kimi has there in the novel's paper, I think it was on your book, where there is a story about the African company which is using the kind of recirculated machines. And
it doesn't have to be far away in Africa. In the US, many schools have huge trouble paying for anything like a computer lab for their kids, and teachers have gone and collected recycled machines and set those up with free software, and presto, they had a computer lab at a very small cost. And with the hardware that's being sold now, that might no longer be possible.
Right.
And that's a huge waste of money. Well, regardless of what you think of free software, it's a rather scary perspective.
And the clean and green ideas, what I was talking yesterday. But
you mentioned in your presentation that with DRM music, it happened that people stopped buying CDs. And nowadays, most of the music sellers sell DMR-free music. So what if this secure boot is the best thing that ever happened to desktop Linux, because now everybody will start buying pre-installed Linux computers?
Quite a negative.
I don't know if that's going... I mean, I'd love for everybody to be able, at least, to go and buy computers with GNU Linux pre-installed on them. However, what's also really cool about free software is the fact that it's so easy to modify. And for me, one of my important experiences in getting to know free software was building my own kernel, which was an experience I today try very hard not to repeat. because my hardware is so powerful, not that I'm my laptop especially great or anything, but the hardware is so powerful, I don't need to optimize the last 5% out of it, who cares? But still, just having that opportunity of building your own kernel and installing that on your own system is very important for many people who go on to become technologists, developers, computer scientists of some sort. If we close that route, we're cutting off the branch on which we're sitting. We're cutting off the source we're cutting off the stream of young people coming into the field. So that's a very stupid thing to do.
You're cutting it with their current computer, which they have, yeah. But it might motivate them to go and buy a 100 euro, 200 euro computer from a Linux company where you can do it. So that will generate the stream of income for all preloaded Linux companies.
Maybe we can find a better way to solve the problem of revenue streams for preloaded Linux companies than locking. Making life very difficult for everybody
my
else.
My point was just that this might be a good thing too.
And DRM is a good example where he was giving this, right? DRM was a good example. It shows that it worked.
Elias, one question and then we go forward so we don't destroy the lunch break.
First, again, a bit of a rant. How many of you people use Facebook? Hands up. How many of you have actually read the terms? Okay, you guys are stupid as hell. the rant mode off. I was among the first to register in Facebook, and I finished my use of Facebook when I understood that they actually are letting third party software to run in your browser without anybody evaluating the software. And that's a security hole which is wide as hell. I mean, it's even more stupid than accepting all the political lies in the media nowadays. I actually couldn't understand somebody could come up with something as stupid as that. And how it has to do with open source is that people generally don't use read the terms, and they bind themselves to something that they are not aware of, and that's exactly the most difficult issue to tackle when it comes to going forward with free software and open source, because people are stupid as hell. They don't care, and they are ignorant and stupid again. And I don't really know how to put it in a more harsh way or even a nicer way, but that's the fact, and that's how we have to tackle. And the really important factor in this theme is that this is all what it's all about in the future. This is what we are talking about. In spite of this being an open source track, I think that these two things sort of conjoin in a very important way, and in this sense we should, you know, join the forces.
Two remarks to reply to.
Yeah.
First, it's important to realize you may leave Facebook, but you leave on the same terms that dissidents left the Soviet Union. You leave your friends and family behind and everything you own.
Actually, I got my data deleted. It was
Yes, so you got the authorities to burn down your house after you left.
Yeah.
That's
okay, guys.
The other, yeah. Ilka, if I may, regarding a more constructive point, regarding the terms of service, a friend of FSFE's is running a project called Terms of Service Didn't Read, tos-dr.org, I think it is. He's been getting a lot of press coverage for that. What he basically does is read through the terms of service of all these web services and evaluate them and label them in a way that's easy to understand. So I encourage you, when you sign up for or before you sign up for a new web service, to check that page. And that project needs your support, and whether it's publicity or money or anything, it's important. So please have a look at that. There's also a very fine South Park episode you might enjoy, but it's rather crude in taste. Good.
Just a short one. Last week's news. If this Japanese mathematician Shinji Mochiyuki is right and has actually proved the conjoinment between prime numbers, and his proof is right, we are running into a situation where pretty much all of the secure methods that we have in use in internet are going to collapse. And that is going to be a big mess if he's right. And we are talking about 1 or 2 years period now.
All right, let's give a big hand for Karsten.
Thank you.
Karsten is going to hang around and being also evening, so you can tease him all day long. And next, we are going forward with National Library, and Aki is going to...